was a hot summer day on July 19th, 1975. I was 16 years old. I was sailing the Bahamas with my family. It was a really magical time. The fresh air, the sunshine, the sparkling seas, it was filling me with joy. And then I fell in love. I fell madly, hopelessly in love with a conch. Well, it wasn't just any ordinary conch. It was the queen of the sea. It was a magnificent queen conch. You know that feeling you get when you've met somebody really special? You're visiting a beautiful place, you're reading a good book, you just want it to last forever? Well, that's how I felt about the queen conch. I just loved it so dearly, I wanted to protect it forever. And it was on that day that began my lifelong journey and my pioneering dedication to grow millions of conch to seed the waters of the Caribbean and Florida. My captivation for the conch showed up in my semester reports at college. And then my college connections led me to the Caribbean, where at 21, I was living in a tent on a very small island, working in a makeshift laboratory, figuring out how to grow the queen conch. As you can imagine, my parents were thrilled. 4 years of college, and their daughter was a farmer. Well, a conch farmer at that, cultivating the seed like the farmer tills the land. And that led me to being a co-founder of the world's first commercial conch farm. That summer, while sailing with my family, the Bahamians were so gracious. They taught me how to collect the conch, and also how to knock the conch. And by that, you take a hole so that you can remove the conch meat out so you can eat it. The conch is a very important protein source for the Caribbean diet. It's also a very important herbivore or vegetarian in the seagrass meadows of the turquoise waters of the Caribbean and Florida. It holds a position of majesty in the islands, certainly a species paying attention to, and I did. But I have a question for you. Did you ever wonder what the world would be like without the queen conch? I know some of you are thinking, this is really the first time I've ever heard of a queen conch? Well, I understand. But some of you might be thinking, well, yes, it's a shell. It's a beautiful shell or a snail. You can put it on your mantelpiece, or some of you might know it as a tasty conch fritter. Perhaps you've heard of the majestic eagle, or the cuddly panda bear, or the mighty whale. But I ask, why not the queen of the sea, the glorious conch that glides so gracefully across the sea floor? So many endangered species such as these, including the queen conch, are threatened with extinction. In nature, between 1 and 5 species each year disappear. Now that rate is accelerating due to human activities such as overfishing, such as introduction of exotic species, and also climate change. Now dozens of species are disappearing, not yearly, but every day. So as a conch farmer, I was working really hard to make sure to forestall the fate of the queen conch. And I remember that very first time I saw a conch larvae using a microscope. And I thought, how is it possible for this itty-bitty tiny thing, just the size of the head of a pin, could grow into something so big, into a 5-pound conch? Well, you and I started that smaller, so it must be possible. This conch larvae, with its long lobes, floats freely in the ocean currents, and it sometimes doesn't survive because it gets eaten by larval fish and also other zooplankton. Conch lay about 500,000 eggs, and less than 1% survive. That's right, less than 1%. Now, this is all part of nature. About a month later, as they've been drifting in the sea, they settle on the bottom of the ocean in the seagrass beds, and they start parading across the bottom looking for food. Now, they start to get a heavier shell by that time. By about a year old, they have spines. What's really amazing is that that larvae was the very, very tip of this shell. And it just kept getting bigger and bigger. It keeps its same shell, the exact same shell, its entire life. And it lives to be about 40 years old. So even with this shell, it's still vulnerable to predators, such as crabs and octopus, fish, and also turtles. But their greatest danger, as you've probably already guessed, are you and me, people. About 10 years ago, there was twice as much conch that were being exported from the Caribbean to the US seaports than there are today. Now, there are regulations in place that help to ensure the sustainable fishing of conch, but there's also overfishing. I don't know if you know this, but this conch takes almost 3 years to grow this size, which is the legal size for fishing. That's a substantial amount of time. I suppose you might say it's not exactly a fast food supply. As a conch farmer, I was working really hard and helped to grow hundreds of thousands of conch in big tanks and also on the seafloor in sea cages. But really, this was just a drop in the bucket. We needed more conch farms, and that's still the case today. As the conch were being fished, a most exquisite gem was making its way around the world as the only pink pearl of the sea. This hidden jewel is rare. Only one in 10,000 conch in nature produce a pearl like this, with such luster and such flickering flame. It's really quite amazing that if an irritant gets lodged inside the conch, it turns into something of such deep beauty. Could there be a lesson there for us? Could our irritations turn into something so beautiful and rewarding? I moved from the Caribbean to Florida, where I continue to be a conch farmer, and at Harbor Branch Oceanographic Institute. And I teamed up with my talented co-inventor, Dr. Hector Acosta-Salmon. And together, we teamed up with his years of experience. He came from Mexico, with years of experience growing oyster pearls, and with my knowledge of growing conch, we set out together to discover how to grow the queen conch pearls. In 2006, Harbor Branch made history. We produced a couple of hundred conch pearls, each taking 12 months to grow to the size of an oyster pearl. Gemologists everywhere were so excited by this breakthrough. Today, the technology has been licensed, and with meticulous precision, we continue to refine the techniques as we speak. So from conch farmer to pearl farmer, I wonder what's next. I know one thing for sure. We need to bring the queen conch back, just like the success story of the eagle. We need to work together to find solutions for disappearing species. For you seafood lovers, learn where your seafood comes from and eat sustainable sources of seafood. If you enjoy volunteering, find a local conservation organization and lend a helping hand. When you donate to a cause, you help our oceans and our planet. So the next time you're asked, have you ever wondered what the world would be like without the queen conch? I want you to remember this adorable conch with the charming eyes and say, restore her to power.